Can hear you, and if
can you hear me now?
I can, yes.
Great, Bruno, thank you. Okay, are we ready to go?
Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you may be watching this online around the world. It's been another busy morning here at the COP. We started out speaking with reinsurance about financing farmers and ranchers across the hemisphere. We moved to a discussion on the Gran Chaco of South America, which had a lot in common with pasture and grasslands. And we've moved on to Bolivia and some other indigenous and gender conversations today. Today, we're going to be talking about circular system pathways for scaling climate smart agriculture here in the home of sustainable agriculture of the Americas, your home. Look forward to seeing all of you. I saw some of you last night and you've all survived. So it's good to see you here today. And welcome again. We look forward to the panel. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Lloyd, and welcome, everyone. This is a program developed by Solutions from the Land, and it also in conjunction with the Iowa Smart Agriculture Group. And I just I'd like to tell a story about that, but really wanted to acknowledge all the help that you've been at the IECA booth and helping us get this started. So thanks for that opportunity. My name's Ray Gasser, a lifelong farmer. We farm in Southwest Iowa. We grow soybeans and corn and cereal rye as a cover crop and as a seed source and also a source of liquid rye in the form of whiskey. So glad to be part of that. It's part of our way that we become more circular. But on our farm, it's a family farm. My wife and I started it 45 years ago. Our son and daughter-in-law are now more than full partners becoming next year. They will be doing most of the operation and Elaine and I will be stepping back quite a bit. But our history is a long history of conservation and concern about water quality and protecting the soil. You know, we've used waterways and 100% no-till for 30 plus years. We grow cover crops for 12 years now to help protect the soil. You sequester nutrients, clean the water, and be more environmentally friendly to not only our environment, but to our wildlife that's around there. So our corn goes to the ethanol plant, creates the fuel that is sustainable for everyone and less expensive in the United States, at least. All the protein that is still left over from that corn, and it goes to feed the animals in our area. And we work with our neighbors who have animals. We don't have them on our own, but we get that manure back to feed the next crop of corn. And that's our sustainability message that we like to talk about. And, you know, we could sing along here too, if you like to. But anyway, our message is a circular system and that we should think more circularly in agriculture. Okay, we should think more circularly in agriculture. And I'd like to introduce to you a group of very smart Iowans that I got to be part of that developed a message and looked at what Iowa's future should look like and what our environmental future should look like. And we believe that we need to be more circular, that we add value to what we do, that create opportunities, not only for us on our farm, but in our neighborhood, you know? And renewable fuel is a big part of it. Renewable energy is a big part of it. In our area, we have wind towers, you know, that generate electricity. You know, we have ethanol and biodiesel that create fuel for your cars and your trucks and those kind of things. And then the byproducts, if you will, the protein that's left over from a lot of those processes do feed the animals in Iowa. And animal agriculture is so important to all of us. And it's really important to a sustainability circular message, I believe. And that's what we're doing. This gets released today. So you're hearing it for the first time in the world about Iowa Smart Agriculture. So then our panel you know, is, could you change the screen, please? So our panel, I'm the moderator, of course. Dr. Bruno Basso from Michigan State University will be on virtually. Joyce Anderson from California will be on. Nathan Bolsaro from Brazil. Bob Lowe from Canada. And last but not least, Brad Doyle from Arkansas in the United States. So we'd like to welcome them and thanks for them to be on, you know, to be on our panel. So Dr. Basso, would you like to talk a little bit about, you know, the things that you've learned as a researcher and what we should be aware of, you know, for to invest in our future and our next generations?
Certainly. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I have prepared just a few slides to really illustrate the role of science and the possibility of showing what the research can do and what has been basically published about. I'm just going to share the screen for a moment.
Yeah, it's up, Dr. Basso. Oh, no, it's not. That's Nathan.
How about now?
That's okay, it's on your screen. You're good.
Okay. Well, first of all, let me thank Solutioner from the Land and the organizers and you, Ray, for sharing this. And it's a pleasure for me to start this very important panel and the possibility of really help you just support the finding that we are publishing and making more tangible for farmers, given the, you know, the nature of this panel. I'm a professor at Michigan State University, and I will be briefly setting the scenes about how we can scale what you just basically mentioned. You synthesize what, you know, circularity on a farm really is, and just to provide some general, pretty clear, you know, bullet points, the principle of circularity is, first of all, is we need to increase use efficiency of the resources we use on the farm. We need to eliminate, you know, design out waste and pollution, keep products and material in use. Fundamentally, we need to regenerate, you know, the natural system and provide economic benefits, because without the economic benefits, there will be obviously no interest, no adoption. And you mentioned already some of the things you do on your farm, Ray, but it's really, those are the key principles that lay behind circularity and high diversity, you know, five-phase rotation, regenerate and recycle nutrients, as including the biodigestate. I will present briefly, you know, a slide on the importance of that. Trying to, you know, integrate better livestock and crops, you know, both grazing crop residues and reuse to for generation of ethanol or biogas. And then for evergreens, you know, be able to have cover crops. These plants take up CO2 from the atmosphere for living. I mean, so we need to have the soil covered all the time. And so cover crops, perennials, agroforestry, where is possible. And precision conservation is relatively, the word has been around a while, but it's a new concept, the way I guess I'll share it with you. And then trying to minimize tillage, you know, no tillage, and be able to use precision technologies. With the advantage immediately of use these technologies, profitability and farmers' well-being, reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, both CO2, N2O, methane, soil carbon sequestration, be able to increase biodiversity and conservation, pollinators' habitat, and soil health and water quality. But more recently, the agencies, the funding agency in the U.S. talk about this one this concept of one health. You know, the healthy ecosystems lead to healthy food, more nutritional, nutrient density foods. You know, the farmers have to be healthy in their own social well-being and minds, and brings the healthy communities, because consumers demand more transparency the way, you know, this cycle works. And so trying to combine things is a very critical thing, including, you know, the overall health of the people in the communities. So one of to what you just mentioned, we basically study these things and see how feasible it is. And so we recently published this paper led by Lisa Schulte about the possibility of the breaking this dichotomy of, you know, food and energy, because this is a typical example that, again, you described, where crops, diverse rotation can be grown, residues can be basically used in the bio, the digester, including residues from livestock, you know, like manure, slurry. And the ultimate product is both bioenergy, it's biodigestate that gets reused on the farm, and the possibility of keeping this in a circular, you know, continuous circular loop without affecting at all, you know, the amount of food that is produced. Actually, it is produced much more efficiently. Another concept, I have basically three examples. So the energy production, the second is how we manage fertilizer in a circular way. And so we learned that through the use of technologies, you'll see this is an example of a yield map that a farmer has to face, you know, and seeing this spatial and temporal variability every year. But it's difficult to make decisions unless they're really integrated from one year to the next across crops. And so I developed this concept of yield stability, where, you know, the areas, there are areas that they constantly produce I and they need fertilizer versus areas that they are inefficient, and independently on the amount of fertilizer that you put on, they may never respond, because for the last 15 years, they never gave you a yield more than 120, 130 bushel, which is very inefficient. So yield stability really revealed the possibility of using this concept as the base layer for prescription of variable rate. And so we were able to scale across 80 million acres. Today, you can click on any single field of the US Midwest of corn and soybeans, and you get this knowledge of how variable your field is from remotely sensed imagery, high resolution. And so you'll have areas that, again, high productivity, unstable if they fluctuate from one year to the next. And most importantly, we also associate what are the causes. Are they more vulnerable to water deficit, or, you know, loss of erosion and hill on the hilltops, or water standing, you know, in the low depressional areas? And so these findings have shown that 48% of within field variability, they are always high productivity, but there is 25% of the fields are basically constantly low yielding, with a nitrogen use efficiency of only 45%, and 27% fluctuates from one year to the next. So these are the maps. There are 23 million acres from that data set of 80 million that they're constantly underperforming. And so one of the concepts that I mentioned is precision conservation, is be able to incentivize farmers to go from a profitability map, convert into what are the areas that you really can boost it and get high yield, versus areas they could actually should be using to a different land use. So increasing biodiversity. And nowadays, you know, the fact that you have perennial that don't use fertilizer, you immediately qualify to get on the market for payments from carbon credits, because you'll be storing, you know, carbon in the roots. And so it's a win-win situation. This is an example of how much carbon can be stored on low marginal land, including this low productivity. It's close to, half a ton to a ton per year. And that's very significant from a climate change perspective. These are examples of currently farmers that receive prescription from us, where these low productivity areas are converted into biodiversity, pollinators, or alternative crops. And just to conclude, we this year, my lab sent 25,000 acres of yield maps without even being on these farms, using, again, the linkage between remotely sensed images and the prescription. But we also allow the farmers to see, you know, the benefits, and, you know, by putting business as usual right next to the alternative management. So this map is really important, because it shows immediately how efficiently this management can be. So you go from not affecting the yield, as you see the graph above. These are 67 fields extracted from the big pool of fields that we have, where the low and stable zones, the yield is not affected if you reduce the amount of fertilizer, but the efficiency and the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions and leaching is significantly, you know, improved from this perspective, close to 100%, whatever they demand. And so with this prescription map, this is physically almost a check because it's a digitally verified map that shows avoided emission. These are the fields that we work with. Just briefly, we can scale all this technology. But to synthesize from the stability map, you can get prescription. You have a map of avoided emission from the as applied map. And this can be sold both as a credit, but also as an alternative commodity price, because those grains were produced with a lower, significantly lower emission. So there is a third of that field should be paid a different amount. And so this is a new concept that I'm trying to introduce. My last slides it's a little bit complicated, but we don't have time to go into the details, but it's basically be able to go from a linear system. You can barely read, but on the left, you have basically the current system where you have, you know, inefficient use on the farm, the water gets lost to nitrate. If you move to one to the right, the technology is divided in what is currently available. So you'll see the graphs of having the biodiversity stripped, the biodigester, and the energy to produce energy on the farm. Eventually, on the long term, that energy could even be used, if it's efficient, almost an electrification of the overboss system. There are new technologies that you can generate fertilizer as well as the biodigestate, having new genetic traits with, you know, deeper roots and more carbon. So ultimately, I'm optimistic because farmers are really resonating to this. They're the best steward of the land. And so circular is really something that is relatively new, but it's basically going on many farms in the US and hopefully in the world. So with that, I really wish you a very good, I'm gonna stick around and I think it's gonna be a great panel. And if you have any questions, please let me know.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Basso. You know, in all the research that you and others do, farmers are clamoring for that kind of information and that kind of research to help them to make good decisions, you know, and we are so diverse and our decision process is so complex that a lot of people don't understand that, you know. We have, you know, diverse topography, we have diverse weather, we have diverse opportunities in markets. You know, it's so many things that we as farmers you need to think about as we make changes and adapt and adopt. And we need all the information and all the technology that we can possibly have to help us to do that. You know, and our real goal is to make sure that we feed everyone and that we protect our environment and our soil for those next generations.
Nice. Perfect.
Thank you. Thank you for your time. You. So you don't have another microphone? You've got one. So Jocelyn is up and she's going to talk about her farm in California. But as you all speak, and we'll just go down the line, you know, tell us a little bit about yourself, your farm, but some of the challenges and opportunities that you see, you know, whether it's weather-wise, climate-wise, or opportunities in other ways to be more circular.
Yes, thank you so much, Ray. My name is Jocelyn Anderson. I'm a fourth generation family farmer from Northern California. So I'm an hour and a half north of Sacramento. If you don't know where that is, I'm about 2.5 hours northeast of San Francisco, right in the middle of the valley. So I work on the family farm with my dad. We farm almonds and walnuts, and we also operate a walnut huller, which is the first step in processing walnuts once you pick them up off the ground and harvest them. It removes that green hull that you see on the walnuts and then dries them in shell before sending them to the final processor. So I'm excited to discuss what circular systems we use today on our farm personally. We have a great circular system for our walnut huller that we use and put everything and all of our waste back into our farm. And then the almond industry, and I say almond, most Northern California farmers pronounce it as almond, not almond. So I'm gonna start saying that naturally so everyone knows what I'm saying. But the almond industry and the walnut industry at a processing level is also aiming to be zero waste and reuse all of the shell and any excess byproduct that they create when they're shelling walnuts or shelling almonds. And how we're also working with that in our orchards. And if we're decommissioning an orchard and taking out the trees, some of the opportunities we have to recycle the orchard and put it back into the ground and sequester carbon at the same time. So some of the challenges we face, I think there's just, you know, we have to have farmers be able to access this information and it be able for it to be used for them on the farm. We obviously face climate issues in California. We've had some major heat waves this past summer that have put pressure on the crop and create a lot of sunburn, specifically in our walnuts. Our almonds last year went through one of the worst frosts we've seen in a really long time. We had a full 8-hour period of below 33 degrees. So a lot of the crop was lost because that was after bloom. So the almond industry had a little bit of a hard time this year. Our orchard, we only had one that had some major damage. So thankfully, personally, we were all right, but a lot of people around us had a hard time. So as we get through introductions, we'll go ahead and share more about the specifics of the circular systems after that. So I'll pass it on to the next person.
Okay, Nathan, tell us a little bit about yourself, you know, your family farm and, you know, what's going on and what your challenges and opportunities are.
Okay. First of all, hi, everyone. My name is Nathan Belusso. I'm from Mato Grosso, Brazil. Sorry for my bad English. I'm still learning a little bit. I have a presentation. Can you put on, please?
Yep. For Nathan's presentation. There you go.
Next slide, please. My family farms only starts in 2004 with my parents. I am the second generation of the farmers there. We grow up soybeans, corn, rice, and beans in three crops in one season. We have a irrigation area that allow us to do three crops in one year. And we employ directly about 15 to 20 employees. Next slide, please. Oh, that's my family. My father, Mr. Valsir, my mother, Iria, and my sister, Luana. We all work in our farm with our employees. Next, please. That's basically my farm. We have a total area of 6,000 hectares. It's around 15,000 acres. And we converge to agriculture, 2,500 hectares. It's around 6,000 acres. And the rest of the area is native. It's all forest that we preserve, we need to preserve by the environmental law in Brazil. And the size is about 3,500 hectares. It's from around 9,000 acres. And that's our responsibility to maintain this area intact. Next, please. We have around 700 hectares of irrigation area. It's about almost 2,000 acres of irrigation area that we use. Next, please. Next. That's a video of my farm. In the same time, we have a bean crop over there in the pivot center with our irrigation area. And we have the harvest there of corn. It is about the month of May, July.
So Nathan, on the previous slide, what was the reservoir about next to the field? Looked like a water reservoir?
Yes, it's where we reservation water for the pivots, for the irrigation area. Next, please. And we have also, with the water reservation, we have a solar power plant. We produce 3.2 thousand kilowatts per day. And that is basically 70% of what we need to rotate all our farm. Another costume that we make in our farm, we recycle 100% of the pesticides plastics that we use. We need to send them to a company who recycle that all for us. And in Brazil, since 2008, we have an environmental law that allow us only to use 20% of our lands. So if I'm new farmer and I bought a farm of 100 hectares, for example, and it's all woods, all forest, I can only convert 20% to agriculture. I have to maintain 80% of the land intact. That's the Brazilian environmental law. So it's a very restrictive law, and we don't receive any kind of money incentive from the government. We have to preserve by our own money. I have in my farm, I have a team of firefighters, because between the months of May and September, we have a dry season in Brazil, in Mato Grosso specifically. We have no drain and high temperatures. That's a perfect scenario for fire. And then we need to build a team to firefight the fire that happens in our lands. What helped us there is because every farmer there has his own firefighter teams. And then when one fire started, we all join forces and fight the fire to end it. So it's really a teamwork that we have in Brazil. And well, we are the shield of the woods. We protect the woods, we protect our forests. And basically, is that the message that I want to bring here in the COP, that producers, farmers in Brazil, we are the shield to protect our forests. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. And when we work together, we all benefit from that. So thank you. So Brad, I think we'll just have you go next and tell us a little bit about yourself and your farm and, you know, what your opportunities and challenges are.
Okay. So yes, Brad Doyle, I am a third generation farmer. Our son is who is home trying to finish up harvest for us at home is fourth generation. We're 100% irrigated soybean, rice, and wheat farm in Northeast Arkansas. And that would be considered the mid-south of the United States, about 60 kilometers west of the Mississippi River near the town of Memphis, Tennessee. And so we also on our farm have a seed company. We do a lot of research. My wife is a plant breeder, but we've got a lot of cover crop research going on right now. Cover crops are kind of a new thing. We've got some great innovators nearby that are getting some national press from that, but we still have a lot of farmers who hesitate. And a lot of that has to do with our topography. We're very, very flat. Live in the number one rice producing county in the United States. Within my county alone, there's about 130,000 acres of rice. So it's a lot of water demand, but it's because our soil type. Our soil type does not drain very well. And so planting a crop that is the primary growing season through the winter is a real challenge. So we are looking for plant species that would excel or either in the spring coming out prior to the termination of the crop. So we, with my wife and I, won a Walton Family Foundation grant in 2019 from the Walmart family. And we are continuing research to try to find, let's say, the perfect combination that works well for and share that information and education with all of our neighbors. I also serve as the president of the American Soybean Association. So we are a policy organization as well, and getting that message out to not only our fellow farmers, but our international customers is very, very important. Soybeans, for instance, 60% of the U.S. crop is exported. And China is one of the largest customers of ours. But we have many, many customers outside of that area that rely heavily on the nutrition of the soybean. If you're familiar with how a soybean is processed, it's you crush it. You can either mechanically crush it or use hexane to extract it. And you divide that into the soybean meal, which would be the primary animal feedstock in the world with a high, very high protein, and the oil. So the oil we all use commonly is vegetable oil, but it is in many, many industrial products. It replaces petroleum in many cases in a much more environmentally friendly way. And one of the newest, biggest demands for it is in the fuel industry. Technology is amazing. They figured out how to create the molecule to look identical to petroleum diesel. Renewable diesel in California is driving a huge demand for U.S. soybean oil. The meal just as important for providing that nutrition for the livestock. There is some degree of food grade soybeans that do come out of the U.S. Japan would be our number one customer for natto. Taiwan is another big customer for tofu. Philippines, a large user for soy milk. So on the rice side, our worldwide U.S. does not produce a lot of rice, but my state of Arkansas, we produce half of the U.S. crop, and it has many benefits for human nutrition, but there's byproducts for rice too that go into the animal industry. And the rice hull is the first thing. The rice hull, amazingly enough, can be used into the poultry houses. So that is used as bedding for the poultry. In return, the soybean meal that the poultry farmers purchase, feed the chicken, and use the rice hull for bedding, we like five or six crops of chickens that live on that. They dig that out, clean it out, and we as farmers purchase that fertilizer and spread back on our farms. It is wonderful fertilizer because it is much more than just nitrogen, phosphorus, or potassium, or even boron or zinc that we would only commonly put out. It has much, much more micronutrients, biological activity, and organic matter. So it's about a ton of fertilizer is equivalent of a 50-50-50 fertilizer analysis. We like 3,000 to 4,000 pounds per year if we can get it. So back to the rice byproducts, when you knock the hull off of a rice kernel, you have brown rice, which has the fat layer, the bran layer still intact on the kernel. If you remove that, you have white rice. So it is commonly eaten. The bran layer, the fat layer, is rice bran is used to feed livestock. If you squeeze that, condition that even further, you can get rice oil, which is a wonderful cooking oil. And the remainder part, the defatted meal, is fed to the livestock industry. So we are well connected. And just those two crops alone, rice and soybean, that we have rotation on our farm, in conjunction with the research that we do. That's what we are giving back to our community in our area. I live in a town of less than 600 people, so I have no neighbors. I live on the farm. You have a pretty good drive to work. Mine's right out. I can just look outside and there I am. So anyway, glad to be here, and we can share more as we go through the program.
So Bob, you're up next. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your farm and, you know, where you live and what your opportunities and challenges are.
All right. Thanks, Ray. And I'm glad to be here. And thanks to IECA for putting this pavilion together. My name's Bob Lowe, and we farm in the very northwest corner of the Great Plains of North America. Southwest Alberta, Canada. I guess it's pros and cons. We're on the edge, where I live is on the prairies, where we winter our cattle is in the mountains, or summer our cattle is in the mountains. We've got a confined feeding operation, a feedlot, which enables a whole lot of good stuff to come in a circular circular economy. I'd never heard of a circular economy till about 3 months ago. And I was doing a YouTube video on circular economies. And I said, what is it? They said, just what you do. So there you are. We live in an area, we've got about 19 inches of rain, moisture total. I took a screenshot of my phone the other day. It was plus 26 Celsius here, and at home it was minus 27 Celsius. I think I'm going to frame that. So we do have a few challenges. Our circular economy kind of thing, as I said, we've got a grain farm. We grow barley, wheat, canola, and peas, and we're starting into a few lentils. A feed yard, which supplies a small amount of the fertilizer for the farm, and a cow herd. The cow herd runs in the mountains, as I said, in the summertime, grazing where grain farming is unfeasible. It's rocks. We run on a reserve that's about 56,000 acres, of which they classify 1,200 of them as primary grazing. The rest of it is rocks and trees, but cattle do fine up there. We seed in the spring, we get one crop. We don't have enough water for irrigation, so we don't get the benefit of that. We seed in the spring. Generally, our growing season is about 6 weeks, first part of June till most years. What we have by the middle of July is what we get for the rest of the year. So we harvest the crops as they need some. We put up for silage, just a very small amount for the feedlot. Most of them get harvested commercially in the grain industry. The cows come out of the mountains about now. It's getting too cold and snowy, and they go on to the residues, stubble from the grain fields. We've been no-till seeding and precision farming for as long as it's been around. We've got to the point that we can't leave the straw on the ground anymore. There's just too much stuff there. So we bale all of our straw. In most fields, I mean, that varies a little bit, but the straw then goes into the feedlot where we feed it to the market cattle, the cattle that we're going to fatten that will go into the food chain. We've expanded our circular economy in the last couple of years. We get 25 to 50 tons a week of fruits and vegetables that come from a food distributor, grocery distributor in the city of Calgary, which is closest to us, that for one reason or another doesn't make it to the grocery store shelves. Most of it is perfectly good food. We squash it up and it goes into the cattle feed. Oh, where else do we want to go with this circular economy thing?
Well, the waste from your livestock industry feeds your crops too and your pastures.
Yeah, what's quickly becoming, I won't say the most valuable part of a cow, but probably at least second, is the manure. We've mapped our fields for as long as satellite imaging has been around and use computers in the drills and in the combines. So we take the manure from the feedlot and we put it in those areas that the fellow on the screen was talking about, that's the low producing areas. And we can bring land back, turn it into a high producing area with manure. So, I mean, the feedlot allows us to do that. We hear a lot of, factory farms and confined feeding operations aren't good. They allow us to really maximize our ability to do everything from sequestering carbon to feeding people.
So thanks, Bob. I think we'll just stay with you on the next question, go down the line that way. And Dr. Basso, this question is really about what farmers need for information and data and research. So, we want to hear from you at the end what you've heard in your research, but you'll be able to hear from this diverse group all across the Americas about what their needs are. So, Bob, what do you see as a need for, you know, for better research or information to help you do even better, because that's all we want to do as farmers. You know, we want to make our farm and our land better for those next generations and make sure it's still there so they can feed people too.
Sure. And I think you can't sell what you can't measure. And what I would really like to see in Canada, I've heard people talking about it, that it happens in the States, but I'd like to be able to measure the carbon that we have, both emit and store, on our particular farm. And I think that data is probably available somewhere. I think that if you could get that down to a farm base, an individual farm base, then you'd really be moving the industry ahead.
Thank you. Brad.
So we have to remember that farmers are businessmen and women, and they need to make a profit to pay their bills, continue their operation, which supports many, many communities and throughout the world. So I think that is the biggest challenge in my area, is convincing the farmer that changing his practice from a heavy till, low cover crop use to little to no, you know, to no-till system, fixing more carbon, planting more cover crops. There, I think that the economics of that, the budgets would be nice. I know we're still in our area, at least, in the infancy of it, because so few farmers have adopted it. That would be very beneficial and for our farmers to adopt, but they need to make a profit. I think with the Climate Smart grants that the USDA have released is going to give U.S. farmers at least a three-year opportunity to take advantage, figure out what may work for their location. Mm-hmm. I've worked with several as a farmer advisor, or, you know, just get my opinion of, hey, what do you think? What would you do for free? What would you do for $5 an acre? What would you do for 20? And, you know, that really gets the farmer thinking of, you know, there's some point where I'm probably going to change the way that I do things. And so without just our government coming in, I appreciate the opportunity to work with them versus just being regulated one certain particular way. Because, Ray, your farm in Iowa, in northern Canada, Arkansas, California, and even South America, we are totally different. And, you know, within a farm, you have different soil types, different topography, different drainage. So I think this will buy us some time, figure out what the farmer needs to maybe work with the climate, problem that we have. And hopefully at the end of the day, farmer's still putting more bucks in his pocket to pay his bills and support his family, because that's what we're really in it for.
Knowledge is power.
I forgot to say I'm director of ProSoja in Mato Grosso. ProSoja is a soybean and corn growers association. And recently we hired a research from university in Brazil, Exalc University. It's one of the largest university in Brazil. And they made 3 years of research to measure the carbon sequestered that our farmers go there. And about 2 months ago, the result is that what we do there, what in no-till farming, we take away 1.6 tons of carbon from atmosphere. So contents all the circle, planting, everything with the fertilizers that we use as well. And we are carbon negative. We are worse. What we do, we sequestered 1.6 tons of carbon. And our idea is to generate carbon credits for our farmers, get some profit for the job they're doing there. Because like I say with my presentation, we preserve, we are the shield of our forest, but we receive nothing for that. We have to maintain our forest intact, and the government and everything that we are here in the COP, they don't pay us nothing. So we defend our forest and we are in steel, we are the bad guys in tier series. So that's not fair in my vision.
Thank you. Jocelyn.
I think there's a huge piece in incentive-based programs for farmers, but with that, it also has to be accessible. So within the state of California, we have what's called the Healthy Soils Program, and you're able to apply for grants to plant cover crop. And we plant cover crop in between our orchard rows. And I know several farmers around locally who have received these grants. The California Department of Agriculture is currently reworking the grants, so they're not open at this time. But I do think that there is some hesitation with applying for incentive programs because there's a missing education piece. Some farmers are resistant to change at times, and I've seen this with my own father who's farmed for many years. But if you can get them that accessibility so that they see that these programs are easy to apply for and easy to implement on their farms, I think that you can get a huge draw. For example, you know, in California, we grow 90% of the world's almonds, and then we grow about 2/3 of the global market export for walnuts. So if we could capture this huge group of farmers in the state of California for both almonds and walnuts and get them on board with incentive programs and show them that you can do it, you can apply for it, and you can apply it to your farm as well, I think we'll be going in the right direction.
Great, thank you. Dr. Bassel, so what have you heard in your research, and what's your reaction from our panel here of what they say, the questions and the data needs are?
So first of all, I am, impressed by this elite group of farmers, but not surprised, because I know there are many, many farmers that may not be aware of the approach of circularities, but they're certainly doing it. There was also a relevant comment from one of the farmers that said, but the majority still doesn't adopt this technology. And I think that goes back to almost the personality of the groups. I mean, adoption, it's just a distribution. You have the early adopters, you have people that they can basically will never adopt until the last, when everybody else is adopting. The economic plays a critical role. So it was correctly said that the intervention like the climate smart commodities priming the pump by be able to allow more potentially farmers that they were more on a thin line of saying, why would I invest on planting a cover crop that costs maybe $20, $30 an acre when I do not forecast, I cannot, tangibly account for the money that will make for me. And so that's a legitimate, concern. And I think that's one of the things that wasn't discussed is that sometimes the operation is so complex, as you mentioned, both, climate and all the timing of things that have to occur, that time is one of the most precious commodities. I mean, there are people that just basically ran out of time even to look for potential grants. And only, big farms that have additional personnel basically have dedicated people to allow to reduce this risk. So one comment that I say, it is foolish to think that the farmers is the enterprise, that only has to bear the risk. The risk of producing food sustainably should be shared. And that's why I'm, continuing to push the agenda of, I work a lot, obviously, in technology, as you have seen, but it still sets me, I'm sad about seeing the fact that farmers continue to put 200 pounds of N on areas, despite the fact that yield monitor has shown them that they produce 130 bushels, 5 tons of grains. So there is a combination and education. I think I'm a biophysical scientist, and without the connection with the social science, it's a lost war. I mean, we have to work much, much more closely from a scientific point of view to better communicate the advantages. And I think even these panels are so important because sometimes farmers will obviously listen more to a good example provided by another farmer rather than, you know, a scientist that may not be able to speak the same language. So the data is there, the technology is there. The fact that we can scale and give prescription map across 80 million acres today may seem a little bit, you know, stretching, but it's not. It is, we are able to provide this kind of information at on any field scale based on remotely sensed images and crop simulation models. The good thing that I'm having, I guess, a little bit of success in getting farmers because I have a grant that they are incentivized to return the as-applied map to me to show that advantage of, you know, be able to sell the grain with a greater price. But also they get the biodiversity areas, the areas that they're not producing, they have the cash rent paid back from the NRCS. So that's an example of potentially, you know, a future policy where these areas will continue. Like the farmers from Alberta said, they can be, basically put back in shape by being able to increase organic matter. And these are areas that, as you know well, before the farms, you know, the fields were had fence line and fields were separated. Now everything is joined and there is no grass waterways. There is one of the major causes of this is basically really compacted, layers. And there's several, you know, reasons. Just to conclude, the science is there, the technology is there. We have to do a better job at working together. And that goes from biophysical science to social sciences. And NGOs like, you know, groups like Solution on the Land, I think play a critical role. That's why I'm up early this morning to be able to provide my contribution to this very important topic.
Thank you. And you're right. When we work together, we all benefit and we learn from each other. And, you know, those of us who travel around the world a lot, you know, farmers learn from other farmers and they respect that information. But we still need your kind of research to help us to those beginning, at least, to make those decisions that they find are helpful and make us more environmentally friendly. So thanks for doing what you're doing. And thanks for being on the panel here. We have one more question. And what, Joycelyn, what can we do to prepare for the future? What are you doing to prepare for the future? What needs do you see?
So I'll share a little bit. I'll go back to a brief overview of specifically what we do on our farm. So our walnut huller, the waste that it creates is there's water that's used, but that's all drained back into our field. That's just behind our processing facility. And then all the trash belt, so that's sticks, leaves, dirt, the holes that are kicked out, and all the bad walnuts that are sorted out through the camera sorters. All of that then is also spread on our field behind our huller, and we work it in and use it as fertilizer and plant a winter crop of either a grass hay seed mix or winter wheat and grow it there. And so we're able to reuse all our waste and put it right back into our land. For almonds in general and walnuts, we are looking at a big push for the entire industry to become zero waste. And so when you're looking at things like if you need to pull out an orchard and get rid of the trees, you can do a recycling program where you can grind the trees and put it back into your land. And they're showing that that's resulting in a carbon credit of 2.4 carbon credits per acre if you're able to recycle your trees after you tear your orchard down. In addition to that, they're using walnut shells for energy sources, for abrasives, and for fillers. They are using almond shells as bedding for animal agriculture. And then the hulls also go to feed sometimes for almonds. So we're looking at ways in the industry to be able to use everything that we're processing, not just from the grower, but at the secondary processing level where almonds are being, you know, sold globally around the world or walnuts as well. So if we can get everyone on board and go ahead and start working towards these zero emissions, which we have some great research going on already to show that it's going to work out. There's even an interesting program that's been researching using almond shells and turning them into a charcoal product that is then mixed with recycled plastic and it makes the byproduct stronger and more heat resistant. And if they're able to eventually make that scalable and actually get it out of the lab, it's a great way that we can recycle plastics as well.
Thank you. Nathan.
Well, for the future, I think the secret is the research. Research and technology. I will do the example of my state, Mato Grosso. Mato Grosso, 30, 40 years ago, is nothing. What is Mato Grosso for 30, 40 years ago? There's no land there. There's no farmers there. So it's a very poor kind of land. And the research allow us to grow there, to make a land a rich land. And right now, Mato Grosso is one of the biggest producers of soybean, of corn, of cattle. And for agriculture, Mato Grosso use only 12% of the territory. And for cattle, 23%. We preserve 66% of the territory of my state is preserved. So we can do that with research, with technology. And I think what farmers in Brazil is doing is using this new technology. If any one of you right now go to my city or my state, my farm, and say, hey, I have a new technology I want to use in your farm. I say, okay, come, let's try. The acceptance of the technology for the farmers in Brazil is very easy. Everybody there is crazy for new technology. So when any kind of research or of a new idea comes, we accept and we try on. And if that helps, we go on. Okay.
Thank you.
I think for our area and for the history of rice production, which started in 1906 in Arkansas, soybean production started in 1926. I think it's water. For our area, water is the key. So my family operation, as I spoke about on Monday, 1985, we took out 100 acres of the farm and created a tailwater recovery system. Fast forward to 2020, we added an additional 50 acres of a surface water reservoir, working with the United States Department of Agriculture EQIP program. And so we can capture all the rainfall on our farm. And in the off season, we have a lot. We have a lot of flooding, a lot of excess water that is just very accessible. We pump up our reservoirs in the off season and use that during the summertime. So that would be another circular system that I have on my farm. I can capture any excess irrigation water. It's at a much lower cost. It's more environmentally friendly, conservation minded. And, you know, there may be an opportunity for smaller farmers to maybe co-op together and do that. So I think that is maybe a vision for the future, if you have the excess availability when you don't really need it. The flooding, we know, it's a huge, huge deal globally. We see it all the time. Find a way to turn that into a positive, if you could.
Yeah, thank you. Bob.
Yeah, first, I think I'd like to the professor over there, because of our data and data management on our farm, we've reduced our nitrogen use in the last 10 years by 50%. And you look, at the price of nitrogen the last year or two, that pays for a lot of technology. So once, you know, word like that gets out, people are going to be looking at it a little more.
Yeah.
I think for the future, what we're looking at now is a biodigester. There's some problems with biodigesters that we haven't quite figured out how they're going to work on our farm, but I'm sure it can come through. And you were talking about water, and I'd like to just a little thing before, because I've got to get out of here. I got a plane to catch. But little thing that Dad always told me, he said, whiskey's for drinking and water's for fighting. And I do believe the most important thing globally will be water.
So thank you all. Thanks to the panel. Thank you, doctor, for being on. You know, and my message to all of you is that, you know, farmers are innovators, and we do want to do the best job we can. And we need to have the help, the research, and the incentives so that we can do the adaptation and still feed our families and the rest of the families around the world. So thank you all for being here. And Lloyd, it's up to you.
Thanks, Ray. I just want to build on that. Farmers are the good guys, whether they're in Brazil, California, Michigan State, Arkansas, Canada, or Iowa. This is why we have this pavilion here. I wanted to note that we have some representatives here from the USDA. We're really grateful for the support of USDA for all of this, and including the negotiations, because they helped us train the negotiators from all of our countries. And at this COP, the Ag Ministries of the Americas have been more present than ever before. So it's been a historic COP for not just this pavilion, but also for the negotiations. So we're very grateful for your leadership, the leadership of the soy, corn, and other industries. The Iowa Smart Agriculture Circles of Light publication released today. And by the way, the U.S. soy video is playing outside, as well as the Guardians of the Grasslands from Canada and the Global Roundtable of Sustainable Beef. So thank you so much for the participation from Solutions for the Land. You guys are part of the good guys. We're here so that your story is amplified over all the noise we're hearing next door. We're going to have to check on who our neighbors are next year, right? But thank you so much and have a great afternoon.
All you guys.